whenever we feel our existence separately, we are different from the Creator, we are separate from the Creator, only because we want it. But once again, whenever we feel the oneness, we are one with the Creator. So between these two stages, it is a child's play, and we live our life as the play of a child. Sometimes we want to be like ourselves, quite independent. We don't want any Creator. We want to do what we want to do. So the Creator is smiling from the background. He says, "You fellow, you want to do what you want to do, but you cannot do otherwise, because what you want to do is in me. Therefore, it is what I want to do with you." That is, the grandfather of the Creator smiles whenever we begin to live independently. And whenever we begin to feel the pain of our independent existence, because we are living different from others, we are forced to like some people and dislike some people. Like some persons for some time and dislike the same persons after some time. So we have to live in pain and pleasure. We have to put up with willingness and unwillingness. We have to live compromised with sorrow and suffering, because we want to live for ourselves. Then the grandfather smiles and says, "How is it?" We say, "It is pain." He asks, "How is the pain?" We say, "It is suffering." He says, "Is the suffering happy?" We say, "No." Then he says, "I like it." We are angry with him, because he likes our suffering. But when once he wants to give his experience to us, it takes no time for us to live one with him. And we understand that there is no pain and pleasure, that there is only existence and experience. That is the touch the Creator gives us whenever he finds us helpless in our pain and sorrow and suffering. See how the grandfather allows his grandchildren play in the garden. But the moment the grandson goes to a reservoir of water or a lake where it is dangerous, the grandfather pulls the string back, and the grandson feels like this, goes back and back. Until then, the little fellow does not know that the grandfather has tied a string around the neck of the grandson and has the string with him. Only at that juncture we understand that we are having our own likes and dislikes. But the fact is, we are not independent. We cannot like what we dislike. We cannot dislike what we like. So we are kept as dogs of our likes and dislikes. And that is the string he puts to us. To make us understand this state, you see an initiation in the 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. There he says, "All this creation is in me." He asks you to meditate upon a particular mantra. That is, to meditate upon an idea, close your eyes and feel that the whole world is in you. Everyone, including your friends, your wife, or each of them say, "I am myself. I am Krishnacharya, I am Benva," like that. Then talk to him, "Who I am." Each of them should feel that I am, that he is the I am. Because All of them are in you. Suppose you are getting a dream in which you find millions and millions of people in yourself. It's not impossible. Because we get crowds of people in the dream. Sometimes we find 5, 6, 7, or 10 people in our dream. They are all made up of our mind. So they are all in us. They are within us, from us, playing in us. That is what happens in your dream. Imagine that in your dream you see millions and millions of. Whenever you say I am, they all say I am. Because if you have 1,000 amplifiers in this street, and if you say at the microphone, I am, all the 1,000 amplifiers say, I am. Similarly, in your dream, whenever you say, these millions of people say, I am. Then tell them, I am in all of you. In the same way, God is in all of us. Then tell them, I am not in you, but you are in me. One step after another step. First you talk to them and say, I am in you. Then you say, I am not in you, but you are all in me. It is also true. Then you say, I am in all of you, because only you are all in me. Because only you are all in me. This is the initiation given in the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, when he asks you to make your meditation like this. Then you will understand the Creator and his creation, and the Creator consciousness one with the creation consciousness. So that is how Brahma exists in us, and that is how Vishnu exists in Brahma. This is one aspect of symbolism. So, the father, the son, and the grandsons. So, we are said to be the grandsons of the blue grandfather, because he is described as one having a blue body. That is what we say, space or sky. So Vishnu is blue in color, but Brahma is brilliant or white in color, because the sunlight represents the externalization of creation. What we call sunlight is only light to our eye, but in itself it is consciousness and not light, because in all the 7 planes, the sunlight exists. We know it as heat to the body and as white light to the eyes, and the 7 colors also. But we do not know what light is to the higher planes. The sun is light to all the 7 planes of our existence. To our body, he gives physical light. That is what we call the heat of the sun. To our eye, he gives us the optical light. To the mind, he gives us the activity of the mind, which is mental light. To the buddhi, he gives us the activity of discrimination. And then, gradually, the other planes also. Finally, he gives us the 7th plane of consciousness, one with the Creator himself, which we say, I am in us. That is what they call the soul. The sun's light has soul light also. It has the light of the soul, which came to earth, shaped itself into the living beings. Therefore, we are able to say, I am. That is what is called soul light, which knows itself. because every one of us know I am existing. The moment we wake up from sleep, we remember that we exist. No one need come to us and say, "Oh fellow, you are existing." That is called self-proposed awakening or self-proposed awareness. That soul light is from sunlight, and the buddhic light is also from sunlight. The mental activity with which we know things is also from sunlight, and the sensory activity which we call the optic light is also from the sunlight, and the physical body has the physical sunlight with which the physical vehicles are purified and kept healthy. And whenever we are unhealthy, health is regained when we expose ourselves to the sunlight. So this is about the creation of the Creator and about His soul, which is in no way different from our soul. Our mind is different from His mind. Our senses are different from His senses. Our bodies are different from His bodies. But our soul is not different from His soul, because there is only one soul. Sometimes we use the word souls. It is meaningless. It may mean something under the boot, because we have souls under the boots. But in the original sense, which we call soul, we don't have your soul or my soul. We have only soul, and our bodies are existing in this soul. That is why it is foolish to say, "I have a soul." The truth is, we should say, "I am a soul and I have a body." We should not say, "I am a body and I have a soul." We can say, "I have a mind." We can say, "I have a buddhi." I have an intelligence. I have a reasoning. I have a logic. Everything you can say. But you can't say, "I have a soul." If you say, "I have a soul," it means under the boot. So about this soul, you should say, "I am a soul." We are related to our grandfather. Because of this soul, we are his grandsons. So this soul, which we call "I am," links us with our grandfather, and it links him with his grandsons. That's why in the Bhagavad Gita he says, "I am the grandfather, the father, the mother, protector, and the child." Take it as an initiation and meditate. That is what he says. This is a part of the symbolism of the Indians. We go into a few more details of it tomorrow. Thank you all. Suppose there is a piece of cotton. There is some fabric from cotton. There is cloth made of cotton. Then a coat made of cotton. So the first step is cotton. Second stage is the strings or the fabric made up of cotton. The third step is cloth. Fourth step is coat. Fifth step is your coat and my coat and his coat. You see, this coat is cut. What is it? That is dye. Coat is dye. But cloth exists. Accept it? But suppose if we cut the cloth, what is dying? Cloth is dying, but the strings are not dying. But the streaks are dying. If you burn cotton, but the atoms are. If we destroy the atom, atom is dying, but the isotopes are not. The electron and the proton, they go into their native places for vacation. That is what we call space. So, this physical body is made up of physical cells. Physical cells are made up of mineral atoms. Atoms are made up of electrons, protons and neutrons. So, what we call the living person inside is only the resultant or the combination of the total. The finest existence which we call space that begins to vibrate. Vibrations are framed into patterns which we call atoms. Atoms are made into matter. Matter is made into earth matter. Earth matter is made into earth atoms. And the living beings are made. Then what we call death is nothing but a chemical change, unscientifically understood as death. It is only a change of state of existence. But whenever the death is complete, there is nothing to take another birth or reincarnation. Just as when there are 10 ice blocks in a tumbler, the ice block which completely becomes water gets mixed with the water in the tumbler. There is no question of itself reincarnating into another ice block, because any part of the water is the same. When you make it in the frigidaire, any part of the water becomes an ice block once again. You can't say it is the same water which came from that particular ice block, again it is becoming ice. See, any part of water can become an ice block once again, but there is no reincarnation into an ice block. It is only a new incarnation and no reincarnation. But if the fusion of the ice block is not complete, suppose there is a little ice block left, once again place in a cup of water in the frigidaire, you will find a big lump of ice once again forming. Then you can say that it is the same ice block. So here also, if the death is complete, there is no reincarnation, because we will go into the background, and once again it is the background that comes out into the front. But many times we do not die completely. We have the above said 7 stages in us. Sometimes we die physically, but emotionally we are still suspended. Then it is said the physical death has occurred, but the person still lives for some moments in the astral body. Sometimes after the astral body is gone, there is the suspending of the personality. That is, the likes and dislikes of the person. He exists as a mental point in space. Once again, he can be gravitated to the astral and physical matter and enters into a father according to the law of magnetism, and then he will be fertilized into the mother. So the death is not complete. After the physical death has occurred, the astral death has occurred, mental death has occurred, buddhic death also occurred, then he comes back. You can say that the same person has reincarnated. But it is often due to our strong attractions towards our previous associations to the lower three planes of existence, that is the physical appetites, the astral likes and dislikes, and the mental association. We are once again gravitated down without the death becoming complete. Then we will take a reincarnation. That is one alternative. A second alternative is when some noble souls have evolved into the seventh plane of existence and they have learned how to live in all the seven planes simultaneously. This practice is possible only while we are in the physical plane, because the physical plane existence is the only complete laboratory with all the equipment available. The instruments and the laboratory are fully at our disposal. So if such a thing were to be practiced, it can be practiced only when we are in the physical. And when such people who have attained mastery over the simultaneous existence in all the seven consciousnesses, they find that the whole thing is a game. It is like a child playing, and a joy and a pleasure. Then when they see people making themselves miserable, swimming in likes and dislikes, they take pity for people. They refuse to get liberated. They want to keep their death incomplete for a very long period of time. They want to keep their death incomplete for thousands and thousands of reincarnations, for the mere fact of helping the younger brothers of humanity, and those we call them the masters. That means they have done the greatest sacrifice. For example, Lord Buddha has accepted to get himself stuck up on this earth globe, to work as presence in all the living beings, until every atom of this earth globe is illuminated. That is what we are told about Buddha. And he doesn't prefer to go back. Though we live in his presence and commit many crimes and blunders in him, causing pain to his presence with our presence. Same is the case with the Christ. So, in such a way, they exist. This is another alternative of the possibility of reincarnation. These are the two cases where reincarnation takes place. And since these two alternatives form part of the karma of our earth globe, here, karma of the earth means the great plan of the earth. We cannot help either having a reincarnation or avoiding a reincarnation. Reincarnation is a fact, and in some cases it is an imprisonment for those who live in the first three planes of consciousness. In others, it is part of their plan, and out of their sweet will they get reincarnated. This is the two phases of reincarnation. Next question. Is it clear? Is it clear? Yes. He cannot come back if he allows his death complete. It is only one, for one person it is possible. That is the creator four phase. Because he is not different from his creation.
the indweller has lived only in the first three planes of existence, it makes sense. A sudden smash in train crash causes a shock of unexpectedness and unpreparedness, and immediately the fellow can be seen by one of the people in the house, because suddenly, instantaneously, he comes home with his astral body, and this shock remains with him. And because of his great attachment to his home and wife and children, because he has not crossed the animal levels, that is the first three planes of existence, he is forced to get stuck up for some time in that condition. Then the law of nature pushes him upwards and the shell is burst. Or if it is still not possible, the whole shell gets reincarnated with all the memories of the relatives in the previous birth. In such cases, we find people who can recollect their previous relatives and go to their houses also. But in the case of those who have crossed the first four planes of existence, entered even the fifth, not even the fifth, fourth is enough. That is buddhic plane. When once a person enters into the buddhic plane, you see, there is a change. Suppose there is a mechanism like this. A person is climbing up a bridge like this with big load on his. The more he approaches the fiber, the more it becomes difficult for him to climb. That is the case with the persons who live in the first three stages. Here is the fourth stage. When once he crosses this, all the load on his head will help him to progress. Therefore, when once he enters into the buddhic plane, the type of death makes no difference, whether it is an accident or a plane crash, a water accident or a fire accident, because to him death is not an issue. To him death never exists. Just as we have seen that to the cotton, death never existed when coat is cut. Completely trailing in the course. Not even a head of a pin we can learn after leaving this world. And when we are asked to transmit something by way of spiritism to others, I can make your fountain pen move in your hand, and I can dictate some matter to you, but I cannot dictate anything that I did not know before I leave this world. That is the truth of it. When the school is functioning, when the university is functioning, we are expected to learn. But during vacations, we are not expected to join in this school and learn something. Not at all possible. Suicide becomes necessary only for those who live in the first three planes. Because after he enters into the fourth plane, his evolution never finds the necessity of suicide, because he has no jealousies, no sorrows, no likes and dislikes. To him, life is a game. No possibility. But when people are living only up to the third plane of existence, plane of consciousness, they are moved by emotions and motives, which make him feel that he should die. Because they mentally accept that death is a fact. and they accept that death is an escape. But when once you know that death is not a fact, but it is only a chemical change, no fool accepts to commit suicide.